Welcome to Just Men, a life-changing program that resonates hope as well as encouragement. The program that gives you information and inspiration for the glory of God. I'm your host, Jeff Tate, and thank you for joining Just Men. On today's program, we have a very special guest. It's his first time being on Just Men. Please welcome Dr. John Kline. Dr. Kline, welcome to Just Men.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure being here.
Man, I tell you, it's our pleasure. And you add value to our program, and we just want to thank you for just making a special appearance.
Okay.
And so we're going to dive into your life, and we're going to kind of break it down into three different areas. But I want to start to just the beginning, your upbringing in terms of Detroit, and tell us a little bit about that process for you.
Well, yeah, I was born in Detroit, Michigan, November 18, 1931. Pretty large sized family. I was the oldest, and mostly the earliest part was it probably when my stepfather married my mother, because my father and my mother divorced. My biological father divorced with my mother when I was about 3 years old. But she met a nice guy, and he came in and took over as a father should. And so it was ironic because this guy was, he's a special guy. We call him Sugar Pops. He started out, I don't know much about his early background, but he started out playing baseball, softball. That's what he used to play. He used to love softball. When I grew up as a teenager, he used to take me to a lot of Negro League baseball games at Briggs Stadium downtown Detroit. But he also got involved in a business. He was a circulation manager for the Michigan Chronicle, our weekly newspaper there in the city of Detroit. And later on, he became circulation manager for all the Johnson publications, which was the Jet magazine, Ebony magazine, and then there were three magazines we handled out of Texas called Barnes Thrill, Sepia, and Jive. And so he brought me up. I first started selling papers for him. I would jump out and take the papers in the store, collect the money, and then eventually I had a route of my own. Now in the meantime, also I was playing, always loved sports, you know, because I was good at doing all kind of baseball, basketball. Well, basketball came later. Baseball was my first love. And then later on, I started doing a lot of jumping. In the backyard, we used to play baseball in the backyard. I remember tying automobile tube between two trees, and I used to high jump over those tubes. You know, we'd raise them up, nail on this tree, nail on that tree, and then I would raise it up and jump it over. So I always had this desire to do a lot of jumping. And so when I went to high school, Northeastern High School was on the east side of Detroit. I didn't play much sports. I played a couple years I played basketball. And I think I ran track for 1 year, did a little high jumping and broad jumping. You know, like I said, later on the next year, after high school, I went to college, started out at Wayne University. I got a little small scholarship. The guy saw me playing basketball. He was refereeing a white guy who was assistant coach of football at the time. But he saw me playing in the recreation league. And he stopped me and he said, young man, he said, have you ever thought about going to college? I said, no, nobody in my family had gone to college. So I said, no, I hadn't thought about going to college. He said, well, I think you'd make a good athlete, college athlete. Said, why don't you go over to the university, tell the basketball coach that I sent you over there, that I recommend that he take a look at you and maybe give you an opportunity to try out for their team. So I told my parents about it. And they said, well, you know, sure, go ahead. So I went over there a few days later, and I noticed in the gym, guys were working out. They were working out. So I said, Jack Cotton, the assistant football coach, asked me to come over and see you. So he said, all right, go in the locker room, change clothes, and come on out there. get on the court. Let's see what you got, see what you know. So I got out there and started playing around. So the guy said, well, look, man, we want to give you a little light scholarship. No room and board, but just we pay for your books, give you a part-time job. And in other words, they wanted me to, you know, play there at the university, which I did, you know, for the next 3 years. After 3 years, I was traveling all over the country because I was making a name for myself in basketball and track. And I'd get invited to national track meets. And then we were playing some real good teams. And I was making a name for myself. So I wasn't spending a whole lot of time in the classroom because I was invited to all these different events. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the third year, I become academically ineligible. And the guy who used to coach me in the neighborhood basketball, he called me one day and he said, well, Johnny, what are you gonna do now? You know, I said, I don't have any plans. You know, he had a lot of confidence in me, you know, as a basketball player. So he said, well, how would you like to try out with the Harlem Globetrotters? The Harlem Globetrotters? You know, my dad had taken me to some games in the past years, and I thought they were the most fantastic team in the world, of course. But I didn't know. I said, is that possible? He said, yeah. I didn't know he had actually played. He was a former Globetrotter himself. Mm-hmm. But I never knew that. All the time he was coaching me and training me and showing me different things, how to play the game. So he said, well, yeah, I can get you a tryout. He said that. So he got me a ticket to get on. I took the train over to Chicago, and I tried out with the team. Guys playing from all over the country. You know, guys trying out. And so one of the general managers, they had three teams, Southern team, Western team, and Eastern team. So the guy says, we'd like to sign you to a contract, $400 a month. So I said, $400 a month, are you serious? I only worked 2 days with my paper route that I had built up in Detroit and outside of Detroit. Mm-hmm. I said, I only work 2 days a week and I make more than $400 a month. I said, I don't think so. So I called Gus Finney, who was my coach in Detroit. I said, these guys just want to give me just $400 a month. He said, well, Johnny, that's not too bad. He said, why don't you try it for a year? And if you don't like it, give it up, you know, go back to your business. So I said, okay, because I was in love with basketball, playing basketball. I would have probably played. And then I played, so when I got out there and started playing, shoot, I would have played for free. That's how much I enjoyed it. Anyway, I played that first year. We traveled throughout all of China, Japan, throughout the Far East, Australia, New Zealand. And the next year, I was told that I was supposed to try with an NBA team. Now remember, this is 1950. This is 1953. And the first NBA player started in 1950.
Dr. Kline, I know that the history of the Harlem Globetrotters go way back in terms of just their impact on society and the world at large. Talk a little bit about the Harlem Globetrotters and what it meant for you as an individual, as well as the impact and the relationships that you develop playing and being a member of the Harlem Globetrotters.
Well, the Globetrotters actually started on the south side of Chicago, out of a high school over there. A bunch of guys got together and they started trying to make some money. They wanted to make some money. Some of them were married and they, of course, wanted to, you know, try to earn a living for that so they could raise their families. And one of the problems they had was they couldn't get into any major venues where they could make more money. You know, because this is 1926 and 27. And it was a lot of racial discrimination, you know, a lot of bias and And so they couldn't get into some of those venues. They would, in fact, the gate sometimes would be about $10 for five guys. So they divide the gate up and it was $2 a piece. Mm. Well, $2 was pretty decent money at that time. But the Trotters, so they had played mostly in the Midwest and around the Chicago area. And there was a team also in New York did the same thing out on the Eastern Seaboard. But like I mentioned earlier, there were a lot of guys that came from all over the country. United States, came all over the United States. They would meet up there and try out with the teams. And those guys, you know, established friendships for years and years to come that would follow. As a matter of fact, there are five guys now that I'm trying to help out financially. All of them in their 80s. And I'm the oldest right now. Currently the oldest living Globetrotter. And so I've been trying to get the NBA and some other organizations to help these guys out. But later on, after I finished playing in 1960, I got involved with an Islamic group in New York with Malcolm X and stayed there for about a couple years and tried to do a lot of stuff in New York. And in the meantime, I've been traveled. And then my last year with the Trotters was travel every country in Central and South America. You know, the Globetrotters afforded me a lot of opportunities to meet a lot of great people, a lot of important people in my life, and, you know, travel around the world. And I don't know, it was just good life experience.
Yeah, let's talk a bit about the man outside of sports. In terms of, I know that eventually you went on to get your PhD, and you're obviously a doctor, but before moving into the education or the academia side of your life, let's talk about the life outside of basketball as a father, as a man.
I got married when I was 20. My wife was 18 years old, and we had a son. And but then I went off to play basketball, as I said, and spent a lot of time there. I was away from home a lot, you know, playing basketball on the road. You know, you don't see your family. So my wife and I ended up getting a divorce. And then I was trying to explain to you earlier that I was raised by a Chinese man and an African-American woman. And this woman was really something else. She kept the family together. She was my aunt. We called her Aunt Ree. She kept the family together. She raised my mother. When my mother had me, she told her mother, she said, "You don't have to worry about taking care of him. I'll take him." So she did the same thing to my mother. She had raised my mother, and then when I was born, she stepped in and raised me. Took me. See, my mother was always nearby. She always lived in a house nearby, next door or down the street somewhere. So the family was always close family, and they always lived in close proximity of each other. But I always stayed in the same house with my aunt. Mm-hmm. And this woman did so much for me, you know, offered me so much love. I used to see her every night. She'd be on her knees praying. And guys used to see, later on in life, I got strung out and using drugs, heroin and cocaine. And so guys used to say that they thought that they knew that how she used to pray for me, that they know that because I was able to work my way through that she prayed for me and brought me through that, those hard times.
So what does this say in terms of just your relationship as a father? obviously you've done well on the court. You had all the accolades on the court, and then when you came away from the game and you began to reflect back on your life, and of course you fell into some form of addiction, what was the resilience about you that you were able to ultimately have a good relationship as a father with your children, as well as being the man?
Well, I was always, you know, I always reflected back on, you know, my relationship with my family. You know, I told you earlier that my family was always close. You know, my stepdad, you know, and my aunt kept the family together. And so even though I was trying to be a father for 8 kids, it was easy for me because of the love that I had received from my family. Mm-hmm. And all those stepkids called me dad. You know, I was their father. I was the only father that they knew.
In terms of addiction and psychology, I know you're saying that you're an expert when it comes to addiction. Share mm-hmm. a little bit about what you've learned in terms of addiction, and what can you share with our audience in terms of addiction or dealing with a loved one who is going through those challenges in their life?
Well, first of all, you know, I think that motivation is important. You gotta want to do some things with your life. You know, you want to, you know, you gotta think about your kids. You want your kids to be proud of you. You want to do things with your life. You want to be successful. You know, it's important to be a man. If you're a man, it's important to be a stand-up person. You know, to value family and to value friendships and, you know, people that you grow old with. And I talked to a guy today. He's 83. He's my closest friend. He moved in my neighborhood when he was 7 and I was 9 years old. And we've been friends all those years, still friends. So, but addiction is something that you have to have confidence in yourself, believe that you can overcome these things. But you need to know how to do it. But you gotta be able to want something that's bigger and greater than what you've got already. So addiction is, well, it's not that difficult to break the habit. You know, you just have to understand how it works, like anything else. I mean, my son would tell me about repairing a car. I had no mechanical skills whatsoever, but I could show him how to kick a habit, because I had the experience, I had gone through it, I'd done it, and I'd helped so many other people to do it, you know. So it was easy for me. So once you do it, like anything else, once you understand how it works, you do it, and then it becomes easy. It's second nature with you, but you gotta do it. You gotta understand how it works, technically how it works. And
what gives you passion? What wakes you up each morning? I know that even at 84, you talked about you're still looking for your next job, your next employment. What is it that gives you that passion?
You know, that's always been a puzzle for me, because I always had so much confidence in myself. You know, I could, when I was a high jumper, you know, the bar would be way over my head. And other jumpers would look up at the bar and say, "No, man, I can't do that." And I look at it and say, "Oh yeah, I can do that. I can do that." Whatever it was, I always thought I could do it. And so I don't understand why I had that confidence. I just believed in myself. I believed I could do things. And once I thought I wanted to do those things, I would just go out and start working on it. You know, like, I never thought about getting a degree, a college degree, but once I decided to do it, then I just went ahead and, you know, I just worked at it and started doing it. I had the strangest thing when I was, after I got off of drugs and I went back to school, to college, I told you I had a year and a half left on my first degree. I was in the I was 40 years old, and I was in the classroom with kids 19, 20 years old. I'm looking around at these kids, what am I doing here? And, but then I just started, started doing it, and it became so easy. Then I understood how it worked, and it became so easy to me. I never got anything less after I graduated my bachelor's degree. I don't think I ever got anything less than an A, you know, because I understood how it worked. You know, once you understand how the system works, you know, that then it becomes easy. And I enjoyed it. You know, I enjoyed learning. And so,
yeah. And what advice would you have for young people today, and what do you see as their greatest challenges facing them?
Well, first of all, do something that you have a passion for. I think every person has something that they're good at, they can do, that they love to do. And if it's something you love to do, do that. You may not make, it doesn't be have to be something you make a lot of money at, but it's something that you enjoy doing. If you enjoy doing it, you can make a little bit of money at it. You know, you're passionate about it, you'll appreciate it for a long time, and you'll do it for a long time, and you'll value it. Mm-hmm. So your passion is always, I think, the key to your happiness. You know, if you follow your passion, something that you figure out what you like, you really enjoy doing, and then do that. Forget about the money part of it. I mean, it's wonderful if there's money that comes along with it, but let the money be the secondary part of it. Do it for the love of doing it.
That's good. I know that in many times when I'm talking and working with young people, one of the things that comes to my heart is completion, their ability to complete a task once they start it. And I like what you said in terms of not chasing the money. The money will chase you as you find your passion, find your vision, find your purpose. Yeah. And so when it comes to, you know, you and I grew up in a different generation, and even my generation, when we started something, we would finish it. And no matter the difficulties, no matter what challenges, we would press through it. How do you see that in today's society and today's young people when it comes to starting something and following it all the way through, that it'll make room for you?
Well, see, that's why I was telling you about the passion, because see, once I find out what my passion was and what my thing in life was, see, I realized that I was a servant, and service was my thing. So every job that I ever had, it had to be service and helping people. See, if I was helping people, I was always happy. Mm. You know, sometimes I make a lot of money, sometimes I would make a little bit of money. I mean, I found ways, a lot of different ways to help people. I used to make money, I would start a program and I would make enough money, I'd make $20,000, and then maybe $20,000 would be my goal. And I put that money away, and then I would travel. I used to love to travel. See, by being a Globetrotter, I got in the habit of traveling a lot. So I love traveling. I used to go to Africa and Asia and different places, you know, just traveling, just, you know, going and meeting different people. And then when I spend that $20,000, I create another project, I develop another project. And then I'd set that $20,000 aside in the bank or somewhere, and then I'd nibble off it, you know, and go around and do other things I'd like to do.
In our closing moments, just share very briefly in terms of just this journey in your life, how would you sum it up, particularly when, and I want you to incorporate in your response, One of the things you said was that you had a relationship with Malcolm X. You had a praying mother in terms of had a relationship with God. And what does religion play in your life, and what does spirituality has played in your life?
Spirituality, more so than religion. See, I studied different religions when I was younger. The Hindu religion, the Buddhist religion, the Muslim religion, the Christian religion. You know, I studied them all, and you know, I thought there was a lot of good in all of them, some good in all of them. I was more comfortable with the Muslim religion because, you know, I liked the tenets of the Muslim religion. And I guess because, and then Malcolm was such a positive experience with me, for me.
What last word of encouragement would you have for men as you look over the globe of your life and you look at yourself as an athlete, as a father, as a husband, as a man, in all of those levels that you've served in that capacity, what last word of encouragement would you have for men?
Well, lift your brothers and sisters up if you can. You know, I'll tell you one little last story. While living in New York, I used to ride the subway. I don't know if you've ever been in New York and rode the subway.
Yes, sir.
So I was working at a post office down right before you get to Brooklyn. I was living in Manhattan. And I catched the A train on 145th and take all the way downtown past, you know, 14th Street till you get to Brooklyn. I was working at a post office there. But sometimes, I was working afternoon, so I'd come home on the A train like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and you know, people would be asleep. And that sometimes I see older brothers, they would go around and they would shake a brother, you know. Sit up, brother, you know, straighten yourself up, you know. And he was trying to send him a message, you know, be a man, be respected, and try to help other brothers, you know, and sisters. You know, let's bond together and let's be proud of who you are and walk, stand tall, and you know, just be a man. And he would, I mean, these guys be laying on, if he was, like I said, 3 o'clock in the morning, anybody would be asleep maybe. But this guy, he'd walk along, lift him up and say, all right, sit up straight, man. You know, so I'm just saying, you know, that, you know, we need to work together for the benefit of the brotherhood, the sisterhood, and try to make something out of our lives.
Dr. Kline, I tell you, you blessed me. We appreciate you spending time with us. We got to have you back on the program again, sir.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I mean, I'll be stronger the next time.
you are strong.
I mean, my voice, I can tell my voice started getting...